important political happening.
That's right. That's right. Absolutely. That's my place.
Delighted to do it.
Okay.
All right. We'll be right there.
Okay. I'll be getting up there. Thank you. The Senate Executive Committee will come to order. Madam Clerk, please call the roll.
Senator Severson.
Here.
Senator Ryder. Senator Lechtefeld.
Here.
Senator Murphy.
Here.
Senator Redonio.
Here.
Senator Trotter.
Here.
Senator Staines.
Here.
Senator Munoz.
Here.
Senator Link.
Here.
Senator Lightford.
Here.
Senator Hunter. President Cullerton.
Here.
Please, that's Senator.
I got you. Senator Hunter, yes. Senator Claiborne.
Here.
Senator Silverstein.
Here.
Chairman Harmon.
Here. We have 14 members present. That constitutes a quorum. Happy New Year, everyone. Welcome back to the Senate Executive Committee. We have some housekeeping. First of all, the State Journal Register request permission to take photographs. WUIS request permission to take pictures and live tweet. The Chicago Tribune request permission to photograph the proceedings. And both WLS Television and BlueRoomStream.com request permission to videotape. Is there any objection? Seeing none, leave is granted. We have two items on our docket today, two separate postings. Amendment to House Bill 4576, President Cullerton's special election bill. Senator Murphy, you'd also requested that we post subject matter hearing for Senate Joint Resolution Constitutional Amendment 11, Senator Raul's constitutional amendment to merge the Treasurer's Office and the Comptroller's Office. Given that I would expect the conversation regarding consolidating the offices would permeate the conversation of the special election bill, we thought we'd lead off with the subject matter testimony related to the constitutional amendment. So if Senator Raul is ready to proceed, we'll ask you to lead off that discussion, and hopefully Senator Murphy will be able to talk about this to your content. Senator Raul.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. As we all know, Senator Murphy and I, a couple of years ago, put forth a resolution to merge the Comptroller and Treasurer's Office and gain the unanimous support of the Senate. And that resolution was not taken up in the House of Representatives. As I've had discussions about that, I know that part of the concerns raised both in the media and by folks in the legislature revolve around the notion of checks and balances and the notion that there'd be some loss of the checks and balances between the Comptroller's Office and Treasurer's Office. I personally believe that that is no longer a major issue. However, the resolution was not taken up in the House, I think in part because of that reason. I have reintroduced the resolution. As we enter a new General Assembly, because I think it would be impossible for us to take up this resolution with the limited number of days in this General Assembly, I intend on reintroducing a resolution to consolidate the functions. I'd like to explore working with Senator Murphy, and I've had some conversations with Representative McSweeney and the House of Representatives, you know, whether there is an option that might be taken up in the House that would preserve checks and balances yet consolidate the functions and save the taxpayers money.
Thank you, Senator. Questions for the sponsor? President Cullerton.
Senator Rawl, just to understand procedurally what you were just saying, in order for us to change the and merge these two offices, we have to do that through a constitutional amendment, and that has to be put on the ballot, and that has to be voted on by the public, correct?
That's correct.
And so the first time they could do that would be in the general election in 2016, correct?
That's correct.
And so the deadline in order to get that on the ballot would be sometime in May of 2016.
That's correct.
Correct? And that is, constitutional amendments have to be passed by the General Assembly. They're not signed by the governor. They're just passed by the General Assembly. In this particular session, the House has adjourned, sine die. So even if we wanted to pass it out of the Senate, there's no special session called for this particular constitutional amendment. Unless that happened, the House couldn't even vote on it. And you need at least 5 days of session in order to have it read, as the Constitution requires, in full, I think three times in each. So with that, I understand that your intention then would be to refile this as early as next Wednesday when we get sworn in some version, perhaps modifications, as you indicated, with the bill that you passed, the constitutional amendment that you passed before. Is that correct?
That's correct. And I'd like to work with Senator Murphy. And again, I mentioned that there's been some interest from members.
And if the constitutional amendment was to get on the ballot and be passed, what's your understanding as to the effective date of the merger of the two offices, if to say the same one that you had passed before? The Office of Treasurer is just been, there's someone just got elected to that. I can't remember his name, but I believe
so
it's Frericks.
We would be looking at 2019, the beginning of 2019. The election in 2018 would be the election.
Do you believe that you cannot pass a constitutional amendment that abolishes or modifies his job that he just got elected to for a four-year term halfway through? Or do you think that we have to wait until 2019?
Well, yeah, I think we'd have to wait to 2019 because logically the voters wouldn't vote until the end of 2016, so we wouldn't have. I suppose we could.
I think the argument would be that the treasurer's got elected to a four-year term,
right,
and that we can't abolish his office halfway through. I think that would be the issue. I'm just trying to find out the urgency of this constitutional amendment and when it would go into effect, I guess, is what's important.
Yeah, I mean, certainly there's been a lot of conversation given the untimely demise of Judy Bar Topinka, Comptroller Topinka, and and others have engaged in conversations because the last time I was before this committee, Comptroller Topinka was at my side making the presentation.
Sure.
However, as you've illustrated, nothing could, our deadline from a legislative standpoint wouldn't be until May of 2016. So that urgency to get something done is not there.
Thank you.
Thank you. Just a little more housekeeping here. WGN Television requests permission to videotape the proceedings. Seeing no objection, leave is granted. Also, for the record, we do have representatives of the Office of Comptroller, the Office of the State Treasurer, having filed in support of the bill but not wishing to testify. We also have a representative from the Illinois Association of County Clerks and Recorders taking no position on the merits. Senator Murphy, are you seeking recognition?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Senator, I appreciate your interest in working on addressing this issue, whether it's today or going forward in the next General Assembly, and frankly, the work we did to pass this out of the Senate unanimously previously. I guess I want to touch a little bit. I mean, and you made this point, and the timing. A lot of times things move when the time is right in this town, and. I think the unfortunate passing of Judy brought this to the fore again, and I don't really think this was something that she supported. This is something that both she as comptroller and a previous treasurer and Treasurer Rutherford all felt like we could do without any concern about safeguards. And I'd like to think in the modern era that we can have enough sunshine on this process that we wouldn't need two offices just for that one reason. And there is $12, $13 million to save in the consolidation as well. I want to touch a little bit on the timing issue because it's constitutional amendments have to be read three times in each chamber. And although we previously have had an exemption to that where an amendment was read before, deemed to have been read before making it out of committee with the governor recall bill. Let's just say we're going to go the typical way. If it passed out of this committee today, it was read today on Thursday, is read a second time here in the Senate on Friday, is read and passed a third time on Saturday, and the House read it the first time Saturday, second time Sunday, third time Monday, and passed it on Monday. If there were a will, that is a legitimate constitutional way to do this, is it not?
I guess the question would be, the other element would be that the House has adjourned sine die, and we're here today by way of special session called
my recollection, though, is that the recently departed counsel for the Senate president had indicated just about a month ago that the Senate president and the speaker together could call a special election if they chose. And frankly, even if they couldn't, a special session, even if they chose it, but even if they couldn't, certainly the governor could, because that's why we're here today. So I think there are multiple ways to get there if there is a will. And I understand, you know, that the speaker has given an indication in the past he doesn't like our bill. I get that. But that isn't a sort of constitutional or scheduling roadblock. That is just a determination by somebody in charge of one of these chambers that they just don't want to do it.
So you know, I obviously appreciate your desire and share your desire to, given the focus on the office and the unfortunate demise of Comptroller Topinka, to take advantage of this timing. But the timing still exists in a new General Assembly to do that, and so the same will would need to exist a week from now when we'd be in a new General Assembly, and the same backdrop sure. would exist a week from now. The difference would be, given you alluded to the that the Speaker may. And others may have issue, and I alluded to in my opening remarks, and some have pointed to this notion of checks and balances, and you and I share the opinion that that's no longer an issue as it may have been at the time of the Constitutional Convention, but you and I may share an opinion that others may not mm-hmm. share, and what I'd like to do
that happens frequently, as a matter of fact.
What I'd like to do with you and with others is explore a way to achieve both, to achieve the consolidation, the savings, and perhaps maintain some checks and balances.
Well, and I appreciate that offer. And in the event that's the direction that this goes, I look forward to doing that. But I just wanted to make it clear. While it may be difficult, it is not calendar-wise impossible to do this right now. It can be done right now. It is a choice that is being made not to do it now. And again, you guys are in charge. You've got the majorities, and that's your right. But it is a choice. It is not that you're dictated by rules or the Constitution or in any way prohibited from going forward with this right now. You could, if there were a will of the majority to do so.
Certainly. And you know, the great thing about this resolution is that it's in the Senate, it's bipartisan, and we're like-minded, and it highlights the fact that, notwithstanding the fact that we may have different party labels, we can think the same on same issues. But the inverse of that is, notwithstanding the fact that we may have the same, that us within a particular party may have the same party labels, we can have legitimate disagreements and differences.
And that's on display right now.
And when that happens, whether it's across party lines or within party, what the structure of our government forces us to do is look for a way to seek compromise and perhaps achieve the same ends that we would achieve if we did it the way that we ideally would.
No, and I think that's absolutely correct. And actually, in that spirit, I offered another amendment to basically taking the special election language from the statute that we'll hear next and putting it onto a constitutional amendment, because there's no question that it is permissible, that there would be no basis for a legal challenge if we did this, if we did your special election law or the president's special election law through a constitutional amendment. There absolutely is a legal challenge right around the corner if you do it by statute. So we offered that sort of in that vein of, hey, you know, where can we find common ground? Where can we work together? You know, I don't know if there's going to be an opportunity. We filed it yesterday. I don't know if there's going to be an opportunity to get a hearing. I suppose the subject can come up in the context of the next bill. But if you're going to have, if you're going to change what the intent was of having constitutional officers elected in off years or non-presidential years, if you're going to do that, at least do it unquestionably constitutionally and do it by amendment to the Constitution instead of a statute that gets rammed through at the 11th hour of one-party rule, which does not set the proper tone from a bipartisanship standpoint as we go into this shared governance model that we're going to start on Monday.
Well, it's not my bill, but I'm going to take the liberty to
respond. I threw it at you. You're certainly entitled to respond.
I think the difference is, as had been pointed out by President Culleton's comments about when we would actually, when we would actually have to take action on changing, merging the offices is May of 2016, an appointment that's going to take an effect as of Monday, right? So there's a different sense of urgency to act. And with regards to legal challenge, you're a lawyer, I'm a lawyer, you can legally challenge anything, whether you really have merit in your challenge or not. I as I read the Constitution clearly talks about the legislature's ability to set elections. So,
Senator,
well, we can have the constitutional debate on the next bill, but I have nothing further on this. And I appreciate you sitting in the chair and pushing this issue forward. It was something that I was pushing for, but it's really your amendment, and I appreciate that you were here to advocate for it. And I look forward to working with you.
Senator Murphy, you have been very able to calculate the costs of per diems for special sessions that you have not been thrilled about attending. Did you have a chance to sharpen your pencil and figure out the cost of the special sessions that would be required to pass or to ram through this constitutional amendment in the 11th hour of one-party control?
Does it cost money to come down here? Of course it does, but that's never held you guys up in the past. I find it ironic that you're real concerned about the budget now.
I'm worried about your concern, because you've always been good about raising for us the cost.
I'll tell you what, I won't take my per diem for being down here for those days if you won't. How about that?
I won't either, because we won't be here. But
fair enough, right. But again, it's a matter of choice. I mean, this highlights the point I'm making. You guys have the authority to do that, and it's fine. But to create the impression that somehow you can't do it is false, because you can. You've made the decision that you don't want to, and you've earned the majority. You have the ability to do that. But don't try and convince people that you couldn't do it if you wanted to, because you could.
I think the question is whether the House could do it without...
Well, the House could do it if they wanted to, and it passed the Senate unanimously. If you put that up in front of the House, it'd fly out of there. But the Speaker doesn't want to do it, and I appreciate that. I respect that. But again, that's a choice he's making. It isn't a calendar dictate that is driving that decision.
A little more housekeeping, please. That Senator Ryder to the roll. And if our guests in the galleries could please silence the audible signals on any electronic device, that would be appreciated. Any further discussion on this subject matter? Why don't we move along? Thank you, Senator Rule. We'll turn now to President Cullerton's amendment. We're going to change to the other posting here. President Cullerton, you have an amendment, Senate Floor Amendment Number 2 to House Bill 4576. Are you ready to proceed?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, I should point out, in light of the debate in the previous topic, we actually are here under a special session called for by the Speaker and myself, not by the Governor. The Governor's special session was limited to talking about a special election for the Office of Comptroller. The Speaker and I wanted to have a discussion about the other constitutional offices as well. And so I point that out in that it's true, as Senator Murphy referred to, the fact that the Speaker and the President of the Senate and myself can call a special session. Indeed, that's what we're doing here today. And just to finish the point, the request that you made about this constitutional amendment that we could have potentially voted on by next Monday, just to drive home the point, it wouldn't become the law. We wouldn't have consolidated the offices when we passed the constitutional amendment. We would have just put it on the ballot so that a year and a half later people could decide. So I guess I'm just trying to figure out what the rush would be, since it wouldn't be decided until year and a half later, and there's been no question that the Senate, at least, is very supportive of the concept. So there's no reason to believe that that constitutional amendment or something very similar to it wouldn't pass very quickly as soon as we actually start the new session. So with regard to this bill, and again, unfortunately, we are here obviously because of the death of our friend. This provides that not just the Comptroller, but also the Attorney General, the Secretary of State, and the Treasurer, if they fail to qualify for their office, or if their office becomes vacant, with more than 28 months remaining in the term, then the Governor shall fill the appointment until the next general election, in which time the voters will elect an office holder at a special election. If the vacancy occurs prior to petition filing, then the candidates of the office would be required to file petitions and run in the primary. However, if the vacancy occurs after the first day to file petitions, then the state parties would choose candidates for the general election. This is very similar, almost identical, to the current method in which vacancies of the office of state senator are filed. In fact, we have three state senators serving, Senator Staines and Hunter, I believe, who are on this committee, and Senator McCarter, who are here by virtue of being elected to a special election. So, with that, I'd be happy to answer any questions, and the concept is very simple. We don't believe it's right for the Governor to be able to appoint somebody for a full four-year term when, at no extra expense to the state, we can have a special election when the general election occurs. And that's why we don't have a call for a special election 90 days, as has been proposed in the past. When there was a vacancy, we have it done in 2016 so that there would be no extra cost to the state, one of the arguments for that. So again, I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Mr. President. We do have the Illinois Attorney General's Office and the Office of the Cook County Clerk having filed in support of the bill. We have representatives from the State Board of Elections and the Illinois Association of County Clerks and Recorders filing with no position on the merit, but Steve Sandvoss from the State Board has indicated a willingness to testify. Any questions for the President? Senator Lochtefeld.
Obviously, this is a special situation. I'm not a lawyer, but I've heard arguments on both sides of whether this was constitutional or not. If you would, in as short as possible, would you give me why you think this is constitutional?
Yes. Senator, I think when Comptroller Topinka died, there was, in addition to great sadness, there was also a real question about, oh my God, who gets to fill the vacancy? And quite frankly, we had gone back and forth and trying to figure out whether it's Governor Quinn appoints somebody for 4 years and a month, or whether it's incoming Governor Rauner after Governor Quinn appoints someone for a month. And we looked at the Constitution, and I really think that when the Constitution was drafted in this provision, they hadn't really thought about what happens when someone dies in that interim period after election and before they're inaugurated. Obviously there were differences of opinion as to who could do that, but to Governor Quinn's credit, I think he said, I'm going to let Governor Rauner make this appointment, knowing he's from a different party. So, but that caused us to look very carefully at the Constitution, and I think it's really an unsettled question. In spite of the Attorney General's opinion, I think there would have been some real serious questions raised. But that same provision of the Constitution makes it, I think, very clear that we can pass this bill, and that it would be clearly constitutional, because the Constitution says that the three words that are key is as provided by law. The General Assembly can do it. It clearly, there's a principle behind it that's obvious. That's why we, when we get elected to our four-year terms, if we leave or die before that four-year term, if there's enough time, we have a special election. It's the idea that the people should have the right to make those decisions. And people voted for Judy, they wanted Judy, but she can't serve. So let's have the people have the right to replace her as soon as it's practical without spending $50 or $60 million that special elections would cost. So it's constitutional, it's practical, and it's fair.
Are you, early in your argument, you said something about the Quinn appointing a replacement for maybe 4 years. Are you saying that may be constitutional? That might, you think that was constitutional?
It's a question that has not been resolved. Okay. The issue is, normally a governor can't appoint somebody past his or her term. That's the general principle. But if you read the actual language of the Constitution and you assume that the people who drafted it weren't thinking about these circumstances, it appears on the face that Governor Quinn would be the one that could appoint someone for 4 years and a month in this case.
But following your argument, he wouldn't have been able to do it for four, only two, right? I mean, if you follow your argument that it was to the next election.
Governor Quinn said that he would appoint someone to the four-year term and support this bill to have a special election in 2016. Even his own appointee, who, let's say it was a Democrat, even though Judy was a Republican, would only be able to serve for 2 years, and they or someone else would have to subject themselves to a special election. That's what Governor Quinn said when he asserted his right to make the full appointment. So there's never any question. This is not an either or. This is, we can do this, and we should do it. And as far as the consolidation, that doesn't take place until 2018 anyway, even if it,
I understand
if
that.
It passes.
Yeah. Well, you know, what concerns me, and I know that you have the power to get this done. You run this body. And I often see arguments made on two sides, and if you were to change everything, let's say we were in the majority, and we were in the position you are in right now, we may try to do the same thing that you're doing. But would you then get up at that point and say, guys, what they're doing is constitutional? Would you be the first one up there saying that?
Well, I think, look, Governor Quinn could have appointed somebody, and there could be a scenario where he says this person stays for 4 years. And then we would be here, because he would have called a special session for that same purpose. We would have be here, you looking at a Democrat being the
I understand. Natural.
So I would say this. I like it to not be partisan. When Blagojevich appointed Burris, there was a lot of debate. You guys wanted to have a special election. And I think what we said at the time was, you know what, okay, we should have a special election, but we better not do it, you know, in the middle of the 90 days later when there's no other special elections called for, and it's going to cost, mm-hmm. I think at one point I got a $63 million price tag on it. Mm-hmm. So I think we're being pretty consistent to say there should be a special election. We're not saying it has to happen in 3 months. Let's do it when it doesn't cost any extra money. I think we're being consistent.
The thing that occurs to me is, you know, we have several lawyers on our side who will take either side depending on what is in their best interest, and
we do,
and I think there are a few over there too. And I'm just wondering, would you have gotten up if everything were turned around and said, guys, what they're doing is good, and this is constitutional?
Well, look, we've had debates recently on bills that we've passed that have some real constitutional flaws, and I think I've made that pretty clear. But, you know, I say I'm not on the Supreme Court, and maybe we need a test case. And so, you know, I'm not saying, as Kwame Raoul said, that we can't stop people from filing lawsuits. But the principle here is really pretty basic. You know, it's not going to cost any extra millions and millions of dollars. The people get to decide, and it's an election. That's how we got here. And we have the same analogy for our own 4-year terms. So why not do it?
Senator Luchtefeld, I think the lawyers on the committee are going to create a scholarship fund to send you to law school. Would you like that? Senator Rodogno.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. President Cullerton, when you started your comments, when you mentioned that when Judy died, there was immediately this question of who gets to fill the vacancy. And I think that sentence encapsulates really what the subtext of this whole discussion about this bill is: who gets to fill it. It's a partisan office. It's one that 36 states don't even have. But it is something that provides the party that holds the office some advantage. And so I think that there's certainly a feeling that this provides Democrats in a presidential cycle where they tend to do better than a non-presidential cycle, a second bite at this partisan apple. And I do think that is a subtext that underlies this. With respect to the Burris decision, there was an effort to not have a special election. It was the courts, actually, I believe, that are the ones that said to do that. So I just want to be clear that I think what we're talking about here, more than the lofty constitutional discussion, which we should have, and I think we agree the offices need to be combined, and I think we agree that we probably ought to provide a constitutional manner in which to have replacements. But passing this bill today, I think, really is just sort of a naked power play. I have little doubt it will be passed. Hoping that we will move forward next spring, combine those offices, and provide a constitutional way to do replacements, which I do think is necessary, and I think is a good policy decision and probably a better policy approach than doing it legislatively.
Well, if I could just respond. If Governor Quinn had taken the position that I think he could have taken, that he gets to appoint the comptroller, and he appointed somebody and said, you're there for 4 years and a month. And at the same time, he said, but I want a special session to come in and have a special election in 2016. And let's say he appointed a Democrat. You guys would be for a special election, because there would be an incumbent Democrat there, and you want the people to be able to have a vote on that. And let's say, okay, you say, well, that's questionable whether the Governor Quinn could have done that, but let's say that there was in the last month or so, Supreme Court decided that, yes, he can. He gets to pick a Democrat. So, come on. It's we didn't bring this up in the past because we didn't have this unfortunate situation actually occur where there is this vacancy. And that's why we're dealing with it now. And it's important to get this concept of a special election. The governor called the special session for this purpose. We expanded it to cover the other constitutional officers, which we should, before something tragic occurs to one of them or they decide to quit or whatever. So we should do it. And it's not meant to be a naked power play. Who knows what's going to happen in 2016? It's not the point. It's the idea that now, forever, going forward, we will have a law that says there should be a special election whenever this occurs. That's the theory, and that's the point, and that's the principle.
Senator Murphy.
I want to touch a little bit on the constitutional argument. Going back through the 1970 notes, it seemed pretty clear. I think Don Clark Netsch was one of the ones who was particularly exercised about the notion of making sure that statewide officials were elected in non-presidential years. And this clearly changes that because you're creating a statewide election during a presidential year. I don't think we want the comptroller elected based on what's going on in Iraq. The other thing that struck me in looking at the Constitution is, and Mr. President, you've made reference to the fact that we have special elections for senators, but the Constitution expressly calls for special elections for senators. So the delegates to the Constitutional Convention, when they made the convention and they made the special election language for senators, they put it in the Constitution. I presume, having done that, that if it was their intent for there to be special elections for constitutional officers, that they would have used the exact same language that they had already created, that in fact you have lifted and put into this bill, and put it into the Constitution in the first place. I think the fact that they did not do that dovetails with Don Clark Netsch's comments at the time that they didn't want statewide elections in presidential years, because if they did, they could have put the same special election language that they put into the Constitution for senators in for statewide officials. Doesn't that constitute a reasonable argument that somebody is going to be able to take to challenge this statute?
Well, as we said, anybody can challenge anything, but the principle is the same, that the Constitutional Convention, they said they want to have these constitutional officers elected in the non-presidential years. That hasn't changed. They're still going to be.
But well, not in 2016. It will change with this bill.
Because they also said in the Constitutional Convention that this provision that we're talking about here, this as provided by law, allows for the General Assembly, and this is quoting from the debate in one of the committees, it's clear that the General Assembly can A, can do nothing, B, can provide for special elections to fill the vacancies other than Lieutenant Governor, but C, cannot provide any other method for filling vacancies. So it was specifically discussed, debated, and contemplated.
Yeah, but never put in the Constitution.
Yes, as provided by law.
Yes,
this is what that language is, and this is the discussion about what it meant.
Yeah, but if they really wanted special elections, they proved that they knew how to put special elections in the Constitution when they did it for the Senate. By expressly leaving it out of the language, they made the decision that the Constitution doesn't allow for them.
Or they said you can let the General Assembly do it as provided by law. And then they specifically in the debate said that they can provide for special elections to fill the vacancies other than Lieutenant Governor.
I guess one last point. and then we can vote, and you guys will do whatever you're going to do with this. The timing of this is you know, it's funny. During the previous bill, the timing was a big issue, and why is this so important right now? And, you know, it just seems a little strange that when it's your opportunity to get control of an office that the voters just voted to have a Republican hold for 4 years, all of a sudden timing is of the essence. But when it's something you don't want to do, timing, you know, we can always do that later. I think the Leader Redonio is right. This is a naked power grab, trying to cover it up with cloaking it in giving voters the choice. Just doesn't pass the smell test, because the voters just said they wanted a comptroller of Republican Judy Bartopinka, Republican, for the next 4 years. The Constitution says that that is supposed to be a four-year appointment. Beyond all of that, though, you know, we're starting this new arrangement, this shared governance. We're going to start that on Monday. And everybody's talking about how they can't wait to be bipartisan together and work on these problems together. And the tone is so important. And the first thing you do, the first partisan punch thrown this year was by you, Mr. President, with this bill. Taking away, I mean, is it really worth having a shot at 2 years of the comptroller's office to start off this new relationship with this tone? Is it really that important to have that office and or have a shot at that office 2 years earlier to do this? You know, the governor-elect had asked that that the appointment be for the four-year period. Is it so awful and so inconsistent with what the electorate wanted, to have a Republican serve in an office that a Republican was elected to for the whole time the Republican was elected? Is that so anathema to what you couldn't let it go? You know, it's a disappointing start for the people in this state who were looking and hoping for a different tone, a bipartisan tone with this. You are not their hero today with this effort, Mr. President.
Okay, so let me respond to your questions. Well, I thought I heard questions. I didn't know they were rhetorical. And maybe I can assuage your disappointment. First of all, I am looking forward to next session and the bipartisanness that we've shown in major, major areas of accomplishments, but one, that being the budget. I'm looking forward to you voting for a budget, maybe even sponsoring it next year. So that's number one. As I said before, this is really important. When she died, we looked into the law, and it's very, very unclear as to which of the two men, Quinn or Rauner, could appoint someone. If there's a strong argument that Quinn could have appointed somebody for 4 years and a month. If he had done that, and let's say the Supreme Court had been litigated, the Supreme Court ruled, it would have been a Democrat. And believe me, this wouldn't have been a partisan play to be here in a special session calling for a special election where you would have had, your party would have had a chance to throw that appointee out after 2 years. So it's not partisan in that regard. Quinn, to his credit, didn't take that tact. Okay? Now, in our research with regard to this constitutional issue, you talked about timing. Why do it now? Why don't you just do it in February? Why don't we do it then? Believe it or not, there would be an argument of the new comptroller that she had a property right to a four-year term that would be litigated in costly litigation. And so there's a practical reason why we should do this before she is sworn in. And it takes away that argument. And that's all I can tell you. It's not meant to be a partisan. The reason why we are here is because of the unfortunate death of Judy. We wouldn't have, I'll admit that. We could have done this, you know, last May, but we didn't, because we didn't think about it, because we hoped it would never happen. But now we're filling in the gaps. We're doing it in a responsible way. The principle is one that we know you feel strongly about. You were the sponsor of the let Roland Burris, you know, not be appointed by Blagojevich for 6 years or whatever it would have been, 4 years. So, come on, This is not meant to be partisan. It's meant to be give people a chance to have an election. We don't know who's going to run. We don't know who's going to win. It's the principle, and I think it's something that we should do.
Would you allow my constitutional amendment, taking the special election language, to move as a constitutional amendment and get a vote in the Senate?
Your constitutional amendment contemplates, if it passed, still not having a special election for this office in 2016.
No, 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 the special election constitutional amendment, SJ.
Yeah.
Which 22.
Which wouldn't
It's the exact language of your
right.
statute,
right.
Which just doing it through the constitutional process of an amendment. Can we get a vote on that?
To, instead of passing a bill?
Correct.
Oh, because you don't want to have a special election in 2016 for comptroller.
No, what I'd like to do is actually create the process yeah. constitutionally
yeah.
rather than unconstitutionally.
Yeah. And then maybe in the future, if somebody ever had didn't finish their term,
well,
then
you
in the
did
future,
express
there could
a concern
be a
about
election.
That. You know, you expressed a concern about the future
well,
as
why
well.
Why don't you vote for this bill, and so we have that guarantee of having that special election, and then we'll bolster it with your constitutional amendment, so that you won't have to worry about anybody filing a lawsuit.
I think we took an oath to not vote for bills we think are unconstitutional.
Well, I hope it's not really punishable by any crime, because I'm afraid we may have done that this last year.
I think that one was constitutional. So can we have a vote on the constitutional amendment? 22, that would do
next
this,
session?
But no, right now, today. We're down here.
Well, we're going to do that routine where we all stay here over the weekend and read constitutional amendments 3 days and hope that the speaker calls a special session for constitutional amendments?
I'd like to think that...
It's not within my control to do that.
I'd like to think that getting this right would be more important than, you know, staying here for a couple of days.
Mr. Sandvoss, did you wish to testify? Just available? Okay. Is there any other... Any other questions for the sponsor? Seeing none, then Senator Claiborne moves that we recommend to adopt floor amendment number 2 to House Bill 4576. Madam Clerk, please call the roll.
Senator Severson?
No.
Senator Ryder?
No.
Senator Luchtefeld?
No.
Senator Murphy?
No.
Senator Redonio? Senator Trotter?
Aye.
Senator Staines?
Aye.
Senator Munoz?
Aye.
Senator Link?
Aye.
Senator Lightford?
Aye.
Senator Hunter?
Aye.
President Cullerton?
Aye.
Senator Claiborne?
Aye.
Senator Silverstein?
Aye.
Senator, Chairman Harmon?
Aye. On that question, there are 10 voting aye, 5 voting no, and the amendment will be so reported. There being no further business to come before the Senate Executive Committee, we stand adjourned.